Thank you for coming.
Of course.
Through your hard work, Muslim Girl is now an online media titan with incredible partnerships. You have a subscription box service, a book, a nail polish collab with Quarterly. You're not just an activist, but an entrepreneur. So what do you think are the most important things to keep in mind when you start a business like Muslim Girl?
I think it's definitely important to understand what the mission is. Because as things progress and move forward, things are going to be changing, new situations will arise, new challenges, new moments, and just understanding what prompted you to start in the first place and why you're there, I think would be the best thing that a business can do. It's understanding what its objective is. And in that way, you know, by extension, understand who you're trying to serve. Who are the people that you're trying to reach? Who are the people that you want to provide services or products to that might not have been available to them before? What effect do you want that to have? What impact do you want to leave on them? I think all these questions, you know, for a business like ours that really came about less for entrepreneurial purposes, but more so for needs of survival, you know, for underrepresented communities like ours. And we constantly reevaluate and ask ourselves those questions as we move forward. You know, how can we do better? How can we really elevate? How can we serve and really just continue evolving in this place that we've really established for ourselves?
The most enlightening part of your book, Muslim Girl, for me was the excerpt where you wrote about being the media's token Muslim.
Yeah.
It was so candid and sad, and it addresses an issue I think a lot of people don't really talk about. Muslim people are just as diverse a group of people as any religion out there.
Exactly.
What are some ways the mainstream media could improve how they address showing a diverse Muslim perspective?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the more stories that we tell, the better. It seems like, you know, the media always wants to portray a certain, even when it comes to actually representing Muslims, it's usually Muslims that fit a certain mold, that look a certain way, that speak a certain way, that say certain things. And of course, that still perpetuates the same issue of that single story, that flat representation that is what we're trying to address in the first place. So personally, I think that on an individual level, the way that we can really push back against that is by constantly telling our stories, constantly sharing them. Because ultimately, everyone has such diverse and unique lived experiences. And yet, those experiences are all so universal. They all bring us together in such powerful ways, remind us of each other's humanity, and make it almost impossible to be able to judge each other and generalize one another in that way. I would say that for us, we have to continue staying true to our voices, continue speaking out, sharing those stories with the world. And for the media, really, it's to portray our voices in the most authentic way possible, rather than trying to swing them a certain way, represent them a certain way, or even sanitize them, but really just authentically letting them be what they are.
What advice would you give to those who want to support the Muslim community and be an ally?
The best thing that allies can do to support the Muslim community right now is really to check your own people, you know? I think that that's the best thing that can be done, because it really does start within our own immediate social circles. It starts with things that seem seemingly inconsequential, like microaggressions, and then they ripple outward, and they translate into, eventually, national policies, like what we're seeing unfold with the Muslim ban right now, largely based off of just a lot of discrimination, a lot of factual inaccuracies against Muslim people. And so really, one of the most effective things that allies can do is if there's a person within your immediate social circles that is saying something that is problematic, committing a microaggression against another people or anything like that, check them. And it doesn't have to be like in a negative way, but an educational one. Because it's like, what's the point of all of us, you know, driving out to the protests and being in the streets if we're not being able to speak, to talk back to like a racist relative at the dinner table? That's really where it starts, right? So I think that finding the strength in ourselves to do that is something that would have a profound impact, even though it seems like it's nothing or it doesn't really make a big difference. It really does.
Thank you so much for talking here with me today.
Sure. Thank you so much for having me. This was awesome. I really don't want the conversation to end, but I guess it has to. I'm sure you have better things to do than just keep talking to me right now. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.